Hello, and welcome back to another week of the Music Map Project. This week is week six, if I'm not mistaken. It's week six. This week is a little late. I had the script and all my songs chosen and everything. Just the video has come a little late because I've been very, very busy with life recently, and I'm in a play, and it was Tech Week last week, so I got a little behind, but here I am, doing 2 weeks this 1 week. Weird, but whatever. My videos have been all over the place, but this week was for the last check-in, but I didn't get it in time, but here it is now. This week's super genre is pop music. My subgenre that I chose is dance pop. The Spotify playlist, I almost forgot. The Spotify playlist for this week is right here on the screen. It is a dance pop hits playlist that I think has all these songs, or most of these songs on the playlist at least. The origins from the Music Map. Let me just directly read the origin of the genre here and then get into what I think and my song recs. In the 80s, pop music changed from a pure trade commodity, records to sell to teens, to a much bigger enterprise, a party and concert industry, where vast wealth was possible to obtain. The Live Aid concert in 1984, for example, one of the biggest concerts of all time, was a pivotal movement. After disco pop, major record labels turned their eye towards dance music, as Eurodance had proven to be very profitable. Thus, dance pop is the fusion of dance, mostly house, with pop, and is not the same as disco pop or urban pop. Although a large amount of overlapping is fairly common in the eclectic world of pop music, where sell value presides over genre integrity. Most dance pop artists are girl bands or boys bands, the epitome of capitalistic pop. Choreographed ensembles of young girls or boys create an illusion of identification by having different stereotypical personality, but all aimed at one thing, selling sex. More than ever before, dance pop market itself to young teens, whether male or female, with the sex appeal of barely older artists. In dance pop, the music is far more important than the lyrics, which only serves as catchy sing-along phrases. Besides girls bands, boys bands and dance pop soloists, a new wave of Eurodance artists started to make an incredibly poppy and lightweight version of Euro House at the end of the 90s. Ushering in the end of the genre, this genre, Eurodance pop, is a lot less R&B influenced than pure dance pop and more up-tempo with stronger beats. This genre is very hard for me. Because I like pop music. I mean, it's pop music, right? So a lot of it is very generic, not like super integral lyrics. Again, it's that sex appeal, it's that money that pop music just generally has. And again, the integrity of dance pop versus disco pop and all of like the overlapping that happens in pop music. But I chose this genre because the songs I picked out because I saw some of the songs on this playlist and I was like, hey, I like some of these songs. I know some of these songs. These are recognizable songs that I can put in here. So it's not like my totally favorite genre, and like I would much rather listen to like alternative pop music and stuff, but I chose this genre because I don't listen to a ton of it, but I still enjoy it enough to listen to it for the project and talk about it. So let us get in to the song recommendations I have for this week. The first song recommendation is I Need Your Love by Calvin Harris featuring Ellie Goulding. This song is extra special to me because I sang it last year in one of my a cappella groups called The Blue Notes. And although the a cappella version is recreating the original song, the original song obviously has much more like tech elements to it and like beating drums, and the acapella is all with your vocals, but it's a really bumping song. I love the vocals on this song, and the beat and everything is great about this song is super catchy, gets inside your head super quickly, just super fun to dance and sing to. The next song I have on my list is Toxic by Britney Spears. The first thing I noted about this song was the high, like, screechy string noises about this song at the beginning of, like, the... and they really add to the song, and the way the strings are incorporated into a song with a really dancey beat, which you won't see a lot of acoustic instruments in dance pop because it's a lot more tech, it's more recent, it's pop music, so you're gonna see a lot more digitized instruments and you're not gonna see a lot of acoustics. And although these are digitized strings, they're still strings, and they add something that some other songs that are a lot more synthy don't really have. So I really like that about this song. And the really dancey beat is super cool in this song, and even the way the sound of the guitar is, like, modified and chopped sounds to make it sound more like a synth, it's still that, like, acoustic sampling, like, digital versions of acoustic instruments, which I think is cool. And there are so many layers to this song, and I mean, like, it's Britney Spears, so, like, how could you not like it? And the weird, like, synthy stuff near the end of the song is super cool and adds so much to the end of the song and is able to keep you listening, because in a lot of pop songs, I said this, I think, during my pop punk week, I'm not sure what week I said this in, but with a lot of songs, you have the first verse and the first chorus and you know how the rest of the song is gonna go, but adding things in the bridge and adding things to the last chorus keeps that listenability and makes it so you can keep listening and get something new from listening to the rest of the song and not just be bored by listening to, oh, it's the same thing just three times in a row. Then the next song I have is Control plus Alt plus Delete by Rev, something like that. You saw it on the screen. The low, like, bumping bass and 808 songs of this song make it really super dancey. The auto-tuned vocals are something that's, like, more typical in this genre than I expected, but, like, the super auto-tune vocals, because obviously in more modern pop music, you are going to find a lot of auto-tune on vocals no matter what, because it's auto-tune. A lot of artists nowadays use auto-tune just to, like, polish it. That doesn't mean they're bad singers, it just polishes the notes that they are singing to make them sound, like, perfectly on pitch. But the super auto-tuned vocals are super unique in this song, because it, like, tries to emulate, like, the sound of a computer. And then in the verses, when the vocals are more raw and clean, you can tell that, like, they can actually sing. Like, and it's not just this digitized vocals, this person can actually sing, this singer. And still, it, like, fits the song super well with both different types of vocals, which I thought was really cool. The song does get a little repetitive, which is one of the bad things about a lot of these pop songs, is they do get repetitive if they go on for too long, which is why nowadays you're seeing shorter and shorter pop songs, especially with the rise of TikTok and, like, short-form video, you're seeing a lot of shorter songs because you need to catch people, give them what they want, like, it's that stimulation. Rather than having a 4-minute long song that has a message, people are just gonna want a 2-minute song that makes them money. But, as I was saying, this song gets a little repetitive on the third chorus, but I still think the song is a vibe, and the saxophone in the song is super fun towards the end as well. The next song I have is Kings and Queens by Ava Max. Right away in the song, the harmonies are amazing. The low, like, bass hitting with the kick together is great. And, like, the Maroon 5-esque, like, ding-ding guitar is super fun and adds a lot to the verses of the song in the background. Like, even though it's not, like, super present in the mix, it's still there and adds that extra layer to the verses. And the thumping beat again makes this a dance. The in the choruses makes this a dance pop song, because with a lot of dance pop songs, you're playing them at clubs or at parties, so you need that just that loud kick, that loud 808 beat to, like, so people can move their body to the beat, you know? You know what I mean. I think that Ava Max has some really good vocals on this song. I love her vocal performance on this song, and the electric guitar adds to, like, this glittery, like, whatever. I said there's an electric guitar thing, and then there's, like, a glittery, like, Owl City Fire, like, booty-booty-booty, like, bridge is so cool. And the held high note into the last chorus that she gives, and, like, the belted higher part on that last chorus, and then the combining of that electric guitar and the melody from the last chorus at the end is all great. The next song I have is Runaway Baby by Bruno Mars. This song is so fun. The guitar riff is super fun and exciting on this song, and again, it has that thumping kick during the verses, the during the verses, and the matching of the drums to the vocals on the run, run, run away is really cool, and the layering on the, like, I love you so vocal section is great. The vocal performance from Bruno Mars is always amazing. I love his voice, but on this song, I really like how he has a more guttural feel to his voice, and this song is just super fun, super dancey. The ad-lib, like, screaming and stuff, again, makes this song just even more fun. And, like, the weird, like, synth rappy section during the bridge is, like, a really cool twist on the rest of this song. And the backing vocals on this song are incredible. I love the harmonies, and this song feels like it goes by so quickly. And it's so upbeat and fun that it just, like, you click it and it's over in a second. But that's a good thing. Like, it gives it replayability. Like, every time I listen to a song, I'm like, oh yeah, I love this song. It makes me want to dance. The final song I have on the list is I'm Good Blue by David Guetta and Bebe Rexha. This is, I'm pretty sure, the newest song I have on this list, and unfortunately by far my least favorite on the list. I like the idea behind this song, and the sample from Blue Dabba D by Eiffel 65 is cool, but it kind of rips on the original song. Like, I would just rather listen to the original song. And the lyrics on this song seem really fake, not from the heart. They just seem, again, it's that thing that I talked about with the origins, with just, like, the money making, but I chose a lot of songs on this list that I like because they, like, defy the norm and, like, have that good part. And obviously, the music industry, it's all about money. You want to make money in any industry, really, but with this song, it especially just feels like, oh, here's a sample from a song people like, let's add super generic lyrics on top of it to just bring in a bag of cash, and make it, like, popular online. And it doesn't seem like it actually comes from the songwriters, and the sample seems super cheap. I do like the 808 drums on the song, and or the 808s and the drums, I guess. Like, both of them together fit super well, but that doesn't redeem this song for me, unfortunately. Not my favorite. It's on this list because it has that sample. It's unique, but it's one of those songs where it's just like, not for me. Those are all the songs I have for this week's project. Here again is the Spotify playlist for you to listen to, and yeah, I will see you next week. Bye.